most of the time for entertainment, I would just go out. You know, you get tired of just sitting in your little guest room with a bed and a dresser. But you're kind of scared to go outside because you know you're going to be approached and you're going to be harassed and you're going to possibly even get your wallet stolen. I mean, it was just always a risk going outside. But I did make friends with this taxi driver, this little nice little Teddy, and he was asking me, "Well, madam, why are you helping in Zambia? Tanzania needs you. We are just as poor as Zambia." And I said, you may be, but I just can only do so much. But he said, "Well, how about you come with me tomorrow and I show you our villages and show you Tanzania as it really is. The town of Dar es Salaam, this is not really Tanzania." So I said, "Okay, yeah, I have nothing better to do." So I go with him in his taxi. And we're driving to try to get out into the villages. And we are finally out to where we're seeing just dotted little grass huts. And I said, "Well, do you think that the people who live in the grass huts would mind if we..." Because I was tired of driving by now. I said, "Do you think they would mind if we just... looked in their hut and visited with them?" And he said, "Oh yeah, I think that would be fine." So we see this little hut and I said, "Okay, let's stop here." And it's up on this little hill and we climb up the hill and he knocks on the door and this lady answers the door and she looks really frightened, just really frightened. And right away he explains, no, that, you know, she's nice, she's from America, it's okay. And whatever they were saying in Swahili, talking. And then she seemed okay. She was a bit timid. We went in her hut. And of course, it's a typical hut like you see in Zambia. And no chairs, you just sit on the floor. And she starts to tell her story to him, and her story is that, of course, there is a drought, and he had already told me about the drought. And when you're trying to live off the land, if the water doesn't come, if the rain doesn't come, then your crops don't grow, and many people are hungry, many people. So this woman's husband, they felt like they were getting desperate enough that he said, "I'm going to go into town and I'm going to do whatever I can to try to get some food, and I will bring it back to you." She had these two cute little shy children over in the corner, and I couldn't really tell if they were little girls or little boys, because it's typical in the village that their hair doesn't grow. I don't know if it's malnutrition or just their genes, but the girls' hair and the boys' hair, they only grow about 2 inches. So you never know if it's a little boy or a little girl. You just say, "Oh, your kids are so cute." She said, "I'm here alone without my husband. I have these two little boys." And then we walked outside to look at her garden, and there was just dirt, and there were 3 cassava roots. They're these plants that they look a little bit like a little tiny palm tree, but they dig up the root and they dry the root in the sun and then they pound it into a powder and they make a mush out of it. And she said, "After these 3 cassava roots are gone, I have no more food. I am very scared. I don't know what's going to happen if my husband doesn't get back. My children will have nothing to eat." It's just difficult for me to explain the scared and the fear in her eyes and just the desperation. I just felt so bad, and I didn't know what to do and he didn't know what to do, and it was just really So we walked out on the front porch, and there was a little jug, little clay jug, and I opened the lid and I looked inside, and there was water in it, but there were these like little tiny bugs swimming around in the water. And she said, "Oh, he asked her, "This is my drinking water. My boys go down to the river, but it's quite far these days because of the drought. So they have to walk very far to get the water. So when they bring it back up, we can only have a little bit each day so that we can just live off of the little bit of water." I'm just trying to explain, really. Again, it always comes back to, should I be helping in Africa? Should I be helping somewhere else? Well, this woman definitely needs my help. They definitely need my help. And so, I mean, felt like I was low on money, but I thought somehow I can maybe get some more money when I go to Zambia. So I gave her my last $50 bill. He gave it to her, and she was just on top of the world, happy, hugging me, kissing me. Just really sweet, and that little family really touched my heart. And there's one other little family that touched my heart. When I was out on the street, a man came up to me and he said, "Madam, do you think you can help me get my mother's Bible back?" And of course, we call it a pawn shop or hawk or whatever you want to call it here, but I had heard stories before, but nothing like this. So I said, "You know what? You show me that Bible and you prove to me that it's your mother's Bible, and I might help you." So we walk, 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 and he goes to this stand and he opens it up, and sure enough, it's his mother's Bible. He told me all about it. And I gave him the money to get the Bible out, but I said, "I want to go to church with you tomorrow, because if you have a Bible and your mother had a Bible." He said, I'm an orphan and I'm taking care of my two younger brothers, my brother and my sister. And yes, we would love for you to go to church with us tomorrow." So I went to church with them the next day. I went to their little home in Dar es Salaam. He became my very best friend in Dar es Salaam.